like I've been lost and let's remember. You think I'm feeling older and missing my younger days? Oh, then you should have known me much better. Cause my past is something that never got in my way. Oh, no. Still, I would not be here now if I never had the hunger. I'm not ashamed to say the wild boys were my friends. Oh, cause I never felt the desire to let music set me on fire. Then I was saved, yeah. That's why I'm keeping the faith. Yeah, 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 keeping the faith.
In the summer of 1934, William G. Wilson, a once successful New York City stockbroker, was declared a hopeless alcoholic. Driven by his drinking obsession, Bill was again committed to Towns Hospital under the care of Dr. William D. Silkworth.
"You have a disease, Bill," Silkworth told him, "an allergy to alcohol. Usually folks like you drink until you're mad or dead."
When Bill left Towns Hospital, he swore to stay sober. But in just a few months, his thirst for booze returned full force. Certain insanity at last gripped his mind. Bill sank into a bottomless pit of uncontrollable binging.
One bleak November morning in 1934, the phone rang in Bill's Brooklyn home. It was Evie T., a longtime drinking buddy. Evie was in New York. He'd heard of Bill's latest plight and thought he'd stop by. Bill agreed. Bill was a bit surprised when Evie arrived. He looked different somehow. And when Bill generously offered to share his gin, Evie replied, "No thanks, Bill. I've got religion."
Evie told Bill how he learned to stay sober through the spiritual principles of the then popular Oxford groups. Bill listened, desperate, but skeptical. Has Evie's alcoholic insanity become religious insanity? Yet Bill had to admit his friend was sober.
One last time, Bill drank his way into Towns Hospital. Here he was consumed by the hollow vacuum of alcoholism. But Evie's spiritual message lingered in Bill's thoughts. Finally, in the state of total surrender, Bill cried out for help. His plea was answered through a powerful spiritual experience. Instantly, Bill's lust for booze vanished, replaced by a warm sense of inner peace and strength. Bill Wilson was never to drink again.
Like Ebby, Bill latched on to the teachings of the Oxford group. This meant living a moral, God-centered life based on confession, restitution, meditation, and sharing these ideas with others. As Bill pondered the miraculous release of his drinking obsession, he grew more and more convinced that his spiritual experience could benefit others battling with the bottle. In Bill's own words,
"My thoughts began to race as I envisioned a train reaction among alcoholics, one carrying this message and these principles to the next. More than I can ever want anything else, I now know that I want to work with other alcoholics."
And this he fervently did. Not one stayed sober. But Bill did.
In the spring of 1935, Bill tried to resurrect his Wall Street career. This quest brought him to the Ohio city of Akron, where the big deal, Bill hoped, would be his financial salvation when sour.
Pacing the lobby of the Mayflower Hotel, discouraged, alone, and broke, Bill, sober but 6 months, felt that old alcoholic thirst returning. Panic gripped him.
What I need is another alcoholic.
A series of phone calls led Bill to Robert Holbrook Smith, Dr. Bob, a physician and fellow Oxford Group member. On Mother's Day 1935, as the trembling surgeon listened, Bill related his vast experience with drinking. He spoke of the mental obsession and physical allergy to booze. He told of Ebby's visit and how he learned to stay sober by helping other drinkers. Dr. Bob was spellbound. Here was somebody just like him who knew what the drinking game is really like. On June 10th, 1935, Dr. Bob put down the bottle for the last time. Alcoholics Anonymous was born.
The early growth of AA was slow. Through the summer of 1935, Bill and Bob recruited members in the Akron area, starting with Bill D., the famous man on the bed. When Bill returned to his Brooklyn home in September, he drew from his Akron experience to form another group of sober drunks in New York City.
Throughout the late 30s, the New York and Akron groups continued to grow. From New York, the message was carried to Philadelphia and Washington. Akron had visitors from Cleveland. In November 1937, more than 2 years since AA's founding, a total of 40 or so alcoholics were bone dry.
In May of 1938, with the help of fellow AAers, Bill began writing Alcoholics Anonymous, our big book. By the time it was published in April of 1939, AA membership numbered 100.
Soon after the big book was published, Alcoholics Anonymous received nationwide attention. In September 1939, the story Alcoholics and God appeared in Liberty magazine. This was soon followed by a series of articles in Cleveland's Plain Dealer. But the real clincher occurred on March 1, 1941, when the Saturday Evening Post hit the newsstand carrying Jack Alexander's legendary description of the Infant Fellowship. By the end of 1941, AA membership exploded, jumping from 2,000 to 8,000 members. During this early 1940s explosion, that Alcoholics Anonymous knocked on the doors of Central New York.
The Central New York area, as we know it today, lies in the heart of New York State. It extends from Batavia on the westernmost border eastward to Syracuse and runs north from Watertown on the Canadian border, southward to include Binghamton, Sayre, Pennsylvania, and Corning.
Although the details of AA's start in Central New York are still sketchy, many fond memories linger in the hearts of our local old-timers. The stories that follow are just a few samples, local legends of how one drunk, talking to another, swept through Central New York in a tidal wave of sobriety. Take, for example, AA's birth in our southeast corner. According to local tales, the first person to bring AA home to Binghamton was Nelson. In 1939, Nelson was admitted to New York's Town Hospital, the place of Bill Wilson's miraculous spiritual experience. Bill personally became Nelson's sponsor. By the end of his stay at Towns, Nelson was sold on Bill and the AA program. His hot-off-the-press copy of the big book became his most prized possession.
Knowing no other drunks, Nelson stayed sober on the power of the big book alone. Then in April of 1940, a fellow member named Harry came along.
Harry's wife was desperate over her husband's drinking. She first heard of AA through the legendary Liberty magazine article. Too broke to buy a big book, arrangements were made to have it sent to the Binghamton Public Library. Ironically, the AA book and Harry's bottom arrived about the same time.
Beaten by booze, Harry was committed to the Veterans Hospital in Bath. Sitting aboard a log one day, he pored through chapter after chapter of text. Harry was astonished. These folks drank just like him, and they licked it. Back to Binghamton he rocketed, soaring with renewed hope.
Harry wrote piles of letters to the New York City office, searching for prospects. One name sent was that of Jay, a low-bottom case from Syracuse. In the summer of 1941, Harry called on Jay in his Syracuse hospital room. Jay, too, caught Harry's spark. AA spirit was on the move.
Months later, in November 1941, former Cleveland member Ted arrived. Ted's zeal for Alcoholics Anonymous equaled Harry's. When these two joined forces in January of 1942, Binghamton AA began to blaze.
Within a month, they had a post office box, stories in the Binghamton Sun, a host of new members, and a firm tie with the growing Syracuse group. Drunks came and went, but the group stayed and grew. Together, they met at homes and offices. Their 12-stepping covered miles and miles of countryside.
Finally, in 1946, Binghamton's first formal clubhouse was founded, the 89 State Street Club. AA was here to stay.
Meanwhile, Jay bombarded Syracuse with the AA message of hope. Like Harry, Jay kept in close touch with the New York City office. 12-step calls from Canandaigua, Geneva, and Penn Yan spilled into his mailbox. Jay answered every call. By March of 1942, gatherings with up to 7 members were held. Ted, from Binghamton, was a frequent visitor.
In October of 1942, the Syracuse band was joined by Lawrence of Lyons. Lawrence spent much of his working day driving around Central New York. Fueled by AA experience, Lawrence helped start some of Central New York's earliest groups. More on that later.
As all this action unfolded on the Eastern Front, the AA message managed to slip into our northwest corner. Dr. Kirby Collier, a non-alcoholic Rochester physician, tried for years to help alcoholics with little success. In 1942, he heard of the fledging movement called AA. Impressed, he brought it to the patient's attention. In his wisdom, Dr. Collier simply told them, "It works. Here it is." Then he stepped back and let them work it out for themselves.
The first Rochester meeting was in a member's apartment on South Goodman Street. 4 attended. 5 weeks later, on April 27, 1942, the Seneca Group of Alcoholics Anonymous was started in room 103 of the Seneca Hotel. An answering service was established. Dialing Monroe 1932 brought salvation to many desperate drinkers.
In September 1943, AA members from Syracuse and Rochester formally joined forces for the first time. The somewhat scattered Syracuse members were ready to form their first group. To assist with this historic endeavor, a carload of Rochester AAers drove east to Syracuse. Spirits ran high, and when the session adjourned, a regular meeting time and place was set, Sundays 2 p.m. at the Syracuse Hotel.
7 Syracuse members were off to a gallant start, but it wasn't long before some minor spats occurred. Lacking experience, the group dissolved within a few months.
But all wasn't lost for the Syracuse members. This brings us to the tale of Mark and Myrtle. Mark and Myrtle lived in Fulton, New York, where Mark owned a thriving machine shop. For many years, the business supported Mark's drinking quite comfortably. By late 1939, 3 years before the rise and fall of the first Syracuse group, Myrtle had her fill of Mark's drinking. It was at that time that she first heard about the new book called Alcoholics Anonymous. Myrtle sent for a copy at the New York City address. Much to her despair, Mark had no plans to live the sober life that the book described. So Myrtle gave the book away, hoping it could help another alcoholic elsewhere.
4 years passed before Mark was desperate enough to reconsider. Then in July of 1943, he read an article in the Sunday American about AA. By now, Mark was a little more interested. So Myrtle sent for another copy. It arrived within days, along with the name of Lawrence of Lyons. Mark picked up the book, put down the bottle, and got on to the business of 12-stepping.
Prospects drifted in and out of Mark's home. Many folks were businessmen or professionals who brought friends, still sore from their battles with the bottle. Together, the group talked the big book, drank lots of coffee, even splurged for ice cream. Slowly, ever so slowly, AA grabbed hold of the city of Fulton.
Lawrence of Lyons arrived in Fulton in October of 1943, 3 months after Mark received his name. The handful of Fulton members explained to Lawrence that they wanted to organize. Lawrence showed them how to register with the New York City office, which they promptly did. Today, October 1943, is celebrated as the founding date of the Fulton Group of Alcoholics Anonymous. Though Mark himself never found permanent sobriety, he was dedicated to helping fellow members. Many early members worked in his machine shop, and many later returned the favor by 12-stepping the man who gave them the start in sobriety.
It was through the dedicated efforts of the Fulton Group that the shattered spirits of Syracuse members were revived after their first group dissolved. Desperate to stay sober, one Syracuse member contacted the Fulton Group. Soon he was joined by another. In February 1944, the Fulton Group helped the two Syracuse members to register. The Central Group was born. 1 year later, in January 1945, Syracuse group membership skyrocketed to a total of 48.
Groups sprung up all about Syracuse throughout the mid-40s. Members appeared in twos and threes in Auburn, Casanova, and Cortland. These dedicated alkies kept in close touch, driving constantly to each other's meetings. All through these early years, Fulton acted as a sort of home base, the group to which many early Central New Yorkers attributed their sobriety.
AA's start in the North Country is a heartwarming story indeed. This is the tale of Doc P., another of those early Rochester members who knew no limits to 12-step work. Doc P. was a rather eccentric little physician from Scottsville. He was the sort of chap who never wore winter clothes, despite the blustery Rochester weather. Small in size, yet big at heart, Doc P.'s volatile spirit towered far above his short stature. Sober in 1942, the little doctor with the big Cadillac was a lively addition to the infant Rochester group. While summering at his Cape Vincent vacation home in 1943, Doc P. heard that his buddy Harold, keeper of the Clayton Hotel, was committed to the state hospital for his drinking. Eager to share his newfound sobriety, Doc P. weaseled Harold out of the hospital and carted him back to Rochester. Here, Harold was immersed in AA enthusiasm. When Harold returned to his Clayton home, he did so sober. 1 year later, in 1944, due to Harold's persistent 12-stepping, alcoholics were meeting regularly in nearby Watertown, a meeting which warms the hearts of the North Country to this day.
As AA fever burned a path on the east side of the Central New York, an infiltration occurred on the Western Front. Back in 1940, a fellow named Reed, who was quite a talented engineer, gained a promising position at a prestigious college in Ithaca, New York. Wheeler dealer that he was, Reed pounced on the chance to leave Buffalo and bring his wife and kids to this quaint little Finger Lakes community.
On to Ithaca they marched, soaring high on hopes. But, as usual, dreams were soon dampened by Reed's constant companion, the booze bottle.
No, it wasn't long before trouble thundered upon Reed and his family. Drunken plight followed drunken plight. Doctors dismissed him as hopeless, doomed to die as alcoholics usually do, painfully.
It wasn't long before the law had their fill of Reed, and finally, as a last resort, Reed was banished from the city of Ithaca. He was not to return for at least a year.
Burdened by guilt, Reed rounded up his family and shuffled back to Buffalo. There, some old friends, seeing the havoc alcohol created in Reed's life, told him of a group that had just formed. Its members were drunks who didn't drink. They called themselves Alcoholics Anonymous. Desperate, Reed decided to give it a shot.
The two members who came to talk to Reed didn't look like drunks. In fact, they were professional men, just like Reed. Patiently, they explained how they and 15 others had learned to live one day at a time, without booze. Fascinated, Reed listened. It made sense. He decided to give it a try. Reed became the 18th member of the Buffalo AA group. Together, they had meetings and talked of helping others who suffered from the maladies of the bottle.
Although literature was scant during the 1940s, the Buffalo members were privileged to receive guidance directly from Bill Wilson himself. Bill and Lois visited Buffalo on numerous occasions, and as always, Bill's presence sparked new life within the infant groups. Bill also served as a source of guidance for Reed. In 1941, Reed decided to return to the rolling hills of Ithaca. Bill's suggestion, if you want to stay sober, work with other alcoholics.
Reed returned to Ithaca. But it wasn't long before he realized that, without his fellow group members, his sobriety was tenuous at best. After he talked with his old group in Buffalo, Reed decided he had to carry the AA message. His life depended on it. So Reed hit the bars. He spoke with any drinker who showed an inkling of interest. Those who wished to try sobriety found themselves in Reed's kitchen. Here, hot coffee and AA jargon perked constantly.
Many came, though few stayed. Reed's early progress was painfully slow, but then one did come back, and another. One drunk at a time, a core group began to grow. By September 1944, a total of four drunks were sober in Ithaca. Area professionals, even the judges who once banned Reed from Ithaca, were impressed with Reed's recovery. They began to send him even their most helpless cases.
Reed didn't confine his 12-step work to Ithacans alone. His extremely successful building business brought him into contact with folks from all over, including Charlie S., an electrical contractor from Elmira. Charlie was losing his own personal battle with the bottle. So, in 1946, when Reed laid AA's tools of recovery at Charlie's feet, he picked them up and carried them south, on to his Elmira hometown.
Here Charlie joined forces with Art, a fellow whose last bender landed him in Florida in late November of 1945. Here he ran across the fledgling AA fellowship. Dry but a month, Art returned to his home near Elmira and immediately opened a post office box.
Alcoholics of the hopeless variety were abundant in Elmira. Within a month, the infant group was five strong, and Charlie was a vibrant addition. His AA enthusiasm touched the hearts and homes of many alcoholics.
With the help of members from Elmira and Binghamton, Charlie helped launch AA in the Valley area. On October 21st of 1949, he called to order the first formal meeting of the Valley Group in Waverly Methodist Church. Another AA group was launched.
Finally, let's not forget the tale of AA's start in Corning. There's a couple of key characters in this story. One is Elizabeth, who, after her release from New York's Towns Hospital in the spring of 1945, set out to form a group in our southwest corner, which was no easy task.
I'm working hard, trying to get started, and now I finally have parted with all.
Despite frequent contact with groups in Rochester and constant interchange with her Elmira comrades, Elizabeth had a heck of a time getting AA to stick in Corning.
The tables turned in August of 1946 when Leon, a wandering ship in the night who sobered up in Detroit, cruised to the Corning area to start a new job. Leon drew on his Detroit experience to set things in motion in Corning. Within weeks, the four Corning members were organized. 4 months later, Leon drifted off to Indiana, but he left behind an AA legacy which survives to this day.
Now I had the time of my life. No one ever felt like this before. Yes, I swear it's a truth, and I owe it all to you.
So that's how it all started, back in the days of our very earliest beginnings. This is by no means a complete description of AA's birth in our area. There's a lot we don't know yet, but the fact of the matter remains. Without the tireless efforts of people like these early Central New Yorkers, Bill Wilson's profound spiritual experience would have indeed been cast off as just another drunken hot flash. Instead, through the 1.5 million recovering alcoholics today, the miracle lives on.
So we take each other's hand, 'cause we seem to understand the urgency.
A little faith and a lot of 12-stepping has brought the Central New York area quite a ways over the past 4 decades. In 1988, over 500 groups registered with GSO in New York. An unknown number of unregistered groups also meet regularly.
Our members tumble in from all walks of life, in all shapes and sizes, yet we all have one thing in common, the faith that through the fellowship of Alcoholics Anonymous, freedom from the black murk of alcoholism can be found, one day at a time.